won't be able to hear yourself on the webinar. If you have any questions, use the question panel on the toolbar. We will be recording this webinar, and everybody who signed up for the webinar will be able to receive a link to the recording within about 24 hours of us wrapping up.
My name is Mike Renault. I'm the Vice President of Marketing here at Vision. I've got 11 years of experience in wind and solar and storage, and I'm really pleased to be joined by Ian Graham, who's our Application Engineering Manager. Ian's been traveling around the world building wind and solar and storage projects for the last 11 years as well. Additionally, very, very pleased to be joined by David Mister. He's got 25 years of experience in technology, renewable energy, and storage. If we have one goal here, it's to start to begin to have a dialogue with our customers and the North American customer base who have a ton of experience building utility scale and commercial industrial solar plus wind projects, and begin to show how to add storage and integrate storage into those from a technical and economic perspective. We're going to do a quick Vision introduction, and then we're going to introduce you to our typical customer that we're going to look at today, which is a utility scale, a water treatment facility. We're going to get into the application and engineering process, talk about how it's different and how it's unique and how we do it here at Vision, get into the economic modeling, and do some Q&A. For those of you who are not familiar with the Vision product, we manufacture a flow battery energy storage system. It comes in 200 kilowatt increments that are a 40-foot shipping container over a similarly sized container. You put these together and you get basically a standard building block. That 1 megawatt building block can be configured and operated at full power for about 4 hours, or it can run at nominal power for up to 12 hours. These products are extremely durable. They last 20 years. And, you know, regardless of the duty cycle, there's negligible degradation. Talking a little bit more about the product, we talked about the long-duration energy and high-frequency power services that we can deliver. It's a pretty unique combination from a flow battery to be able to deliver power services at any state of charge. We take a lot of pride in the safety of our chemistry. It helps our customers deploy these systems very close to the grid edge, very close to large businesses and places where people like to live, play, and work. In addition, when you look at the all-in cost versus the other available large-scale and medium-scale storage technologies that are out there side-by-side, most of our customers pretty quickly come to the conclusion that we have a superior IRR or ROI. I talked a little bit about the services we can provide, both power and energy, and it's important to think about those as you start to evaluate the types of storage projects you're going to go after. Even behind-the-meter projects have significant opportunities for income that we'll talk about later from wholesale services. So a battery platform that has that kind of versatility, that has the ability to go after both wholesale services and behind-the-meter applications, is something that's critical to optimizing your economics for any given use case. We talked about versatility. Most of you will recognize this graph. It's been floating around in our market space for quite some time. You know, on one axis you have your discharge duration. On the other axis you have your frequency of use. The color of the box is basically whether it's a customer site or front of meter application. The gray boxes are both sides of the meter. We're going to be talking about applications today that have use cases and services required from the battery that are essentially both customer site and front of meter application. As you go from ISO to ISO and different territories around the world, you're going to find that the income from your energy storage system is a healthy and local mix of these types of income streams. So let's first talk about the example project today, wastewater treatment facilities. We could have picked any typical project, but we thought this was a good way to start the discussion. There are 8,000 of these in the United States. On average, they spend about $1.5 million a year on energy. The one we're talking about today is in Southern California. When you look at both their power and their energy spend, it's about 17 cents a kilowatt hour because it's an SCE TOU-8 energy bill region. We'll talk a little bit more about what that means later. About half of these facilities in the U.S. are private, the other half are public. It's pretty high on the mission critical side of things in terms of the energy, right? I mean, this is a critical piece of municipal infrastructure. There's decent power spikes when all their pumps and all their equipment wants to start at the same time. The EHS of the battery, because essentially, you know, the majority of the water for a given territory will be flowing through this, it's critical as well. So the overall toxicity and chemical makeup of the battery is something to take into consideration when you're pursuing opportunities like these. Typically, there's some diesel. And the other nice thing here in North America is most of these have enough space for some PV, which, as most of us know, has become pretty much the cheapest fuel around. What for years I've been calling application engineering, today I've got to call it value engineering, right? Because as we start transitioning into understanding the economic flows that make these projects work, it's all about finding the value in the local project. The vision process is 8 steps. We start with an NDA. We treat these projects in a very confidential manner. All of our customers work together with us hand in hand to understand how to make the project work. We collect some project data that we'll tell you about. We work together with our customers to research various revenue streams. We optimize everything in a process which we'll discuss in a bit. We then turn it around and we provide a whole system bill of materials, what we think is a rock solid estimate for all in turnkey BOM costing, a full 20-year project pro forma in an open source type of environment, and we help our customers deliver end user proposals and support. The entire process is designed to teach experienced renewable energy companies how to fish with flourish. With that, I want to do page 1 of 2 here of the value engineering process. I said we had to collect some data. I'm bringing in Ian Graham, our head of application engineering. Ian, this is a pretty big list of data.
Yeah, good afternoon, everybody. This is Ian. The whole point of doing this study was really to address the economic benefits of putting in storage. And what we're focusing on today is commercial and industrial sites. So what you see, I'm going to go through this whole list. What you see in front of us is how we define what we call the economic stool, how these projects are elevated into, you know, an acceptable return. So really the three major parts are defining the cost of energy on site, and that requires us getting the best possible information on load and the best possible information on tariffs. So we, for these large customers, come up with a really salient cost of energy per year. They say, okay, great, and we start to run optimization with both PV and storage to figure out the savings component. How much can we save you on power and energy and leverage what's already going on site? So that's the first leg of the stool, and for C&I is a very important piece. The second is renewable energy application and integration. Mainly what that means is how to leverage higher amounts of PV beyond a typical net metering structure or beyond a typical interconnection agreement. So higher amounts of energy beyond the meter to sort of leverage the first stool cost of energy. The last piece, in my mind, the most exciting is sort of this ancillary services with the utility. That goes from the traditional market of demand response to other markets like regulation and capacity. So basically through this process of sharing data, you know, we work together jointly to sort of figure out what the bounds are in the economic stool. So as we get into the site details, we've got both grid interconnection, availability, region, that sort of flow into the process of creating what we call a feasibility study. And that's really what you guys are looking for. And what that means is that we can figure out what the total IRR is for the site and what type of sizing you would need to be a solid project.
All right, Ian. Well, that's a lot of information, and I'm sure it's definitely something that you've looked at hundreds of times. I've got some basic rules of thumb here, and is there any way that you can just sort of lay it out for us in terms of what our customers should look for and kind of what they should hunt for in terms of typical facilities that have economics that look good?
Yeah, no problem. So for commercial industrial sites, with the cost of energy in mind, so the first leg of the stool, we're looking for sites that are typically above 10 cents a kilowatt hour levelized or 10 bucks a kW in demand, and that's utilizing the tax incentive. If you're outside of the U.S. or outside of the ITC realm, then we look at cost of energy around 15 cents or greater than 15 bucks a kW, and this would solidify the first leg of the stool. And as I alluded to before, that can be supplemented by wholesale services in many of the major markets in the North America as well as otherwhere in the world. So that starts out with demand response. Obviously, regulation has been a big part of the industry. We certainly are able to address that in synchronous reserves, emergency reserves, capacity reserves as well. And so what that all synthesizes down into is combining those three legs will get you a very attractive CNI site for storage. So the markets and regions that we have been working in for the past 2 years include PJM, ERCOT, California, the New England, New York ISOs. And so we've been able to work with not only just ourselves, but folks in the energy integration, energy services, businesses to sort of help us figure out what, both ancillary services and cost of energy, really is in all these other markets. And so we are certainly happy to help you guys work through that for various projects in these regions. And we can kind of show you which regions are at this time good, a good application for storage, and maybe ones that are kind of down the road, and how that relates to, the three legs of the economic stool. As, very generally, East and West Coast have very high cost of energy. The Midwest and middle part of the North America can be supplemented. You can supplement low cost of energy with things like ancillary services. So we can kind of help you coach you through, these various regions.
So Ian, that's fascinating. And let's go back to our water treatment facility and let's take a good look at what we do when we receive all the data, how we optimize the system, how we look at the data, and how we turn that into something which is the optimal configuration.
Yeah, so the process is pretty straightforward. So once we begin, start to share data, we start to look at the load side and start to address the cost of energy. And that is getting your load profile and integrating it up into what you see in front of you. This is an output from one of our models in Homer, and it sort of gives us the sort of annual cost of energy. And this would relate to an overlay of what their consumption tariff would be.
What do these different colors mean?
So basically what we have is, variability on their load profile throughout the year with weekends and everything included. So we take 15-minute interval data and load it up for an entire year and look at what that equates to for cost of energy.
And then so what does our software do? What does the software we use do, and how does it optimize?
So after we figure out what their current cost of energy is, now we can start to add in both solar and battery. And a lot of these sites have been already currently sized for solar, or there's already a sort of design parameters on that side. So we can start to load in both the cost of solar, the cost of battery, and what the value of the savings would be. and we use Homer and other tools to optimize based on energy savings. So what would be the net benefit of installing solar plus storage to install the system? It's very similar to straight PV economics or any other sort of renewable energy.
And so how would this look different if it was, let's just say, a lithium ion system versus a Vision Flow battery?
Good question. So in this first phase on the cost of energy, the systems will act and look very similar. For us, we have some inherent differences in terms of other solid state batteries in terms of being able to support higher lifetimes beyond doing peak shaving, as well as supporting ancillary services, which would be beyond sort of standalone peak shaving.
Thanks a lot, Ian. That's a big step for us in terms of qualifying and nailing down the bill of materials. And that's really when we start to transition each project out of application engineering into the next step, which is project economics. And I'm joined now by David Mincer, and I'm on slide 18 of the presentation. And, you know, David, you have, together with a big team of industry experts, built a all-in first cost system estimate. Can you tell us about this tool and how it works?
Good afternoon, Rick. Thanks for having me. Basically, what our customers want is a complete solution to solve their problems. It's something we're happy to support. We do it often. We're supported by no small number of partners where we can pull together indicative turnkey pricing ranging from the inverters, the PCS provider, controls, controls logic, financial dispatch engines, EPCs that include the rest of the balance of the system, the installation, the soft costs, and in doing so, help our customers have a much better expression of what the all-in CapEx structure for that particular installation, which is what you see on the right. And for this application, you can see our contribution as well as everybody else's reflected in the dollar per kWh basis.
And is this a tool that's in Excel that customers can easily get access to that they can see?
Yes, it is. That's a great question. It's all in Excel, and just about every time we provide this sort of feedback to our customers, customers could also include our finance brethren, we provide this tool as a financial expression of that particular project, all in.
Great. So customers are really interested in first cost, but they're also interested in O&M. We have a big O&M generator in our tool. Can you tell me a little bit about that?
Sure. That's a great part of the overall contribution to what our customers and our partners have to manage, in part because we have a long-lived asset, right? It's 20 years, unlike lithium ion, which is typically not 20 years, and definitely not without significant replacements. Of course, we model that because it's an essential part of the total cost of ownership for the platform. For example, Mike, we have some replacements. Everybody has replacements. The replacements for us are definitely not on the battery. It's not on the cell, it's not on the electrolytes, it's not on the chemistry. We have to change two pumps. We know that they're roughly 10-year assets, but we model it 7 years in order to be extra conservative. In stark contrast, lithium ions, very good ones, rarely last 10 years, rarely last 7 years. We've modeled it at 8 in order to be conservative and to find a middle place. That said, there are cells that have to be replaced, which means you've taken a commission system and you've decommissioned it. You have to replace those with labor and then recommission an otherwise fully working revenue-generating asset. And the exposure differences between the two platforms are stunning.
That's really interesting. I also want to just make the comment that all of this is open source, right? So when we provide our best and most conservative estimates, isn't it correct that if a developer or an EPC felt like our assumptions were not conservative enough or inaccurate, he or she could go and insert their own estimates?
That's correct, Mike. If they have some other thought on the O&M exposure or first costs or any of the key attributes, the Excel tool is transparent. We almost treat it like shareware. Happy to provide it if there's a good project for us.
Thanks, David.
Getting back to our friendly water treatment facility, we talked about this being an SCE-TOU-8. We've become pretty comfortable in the areas of the country that have utility rates that hunt. Talk a little bit about how our knowledge in these areas are helping our customers explain our value to their customers.
So in this model, I'm going to go back to this for a quick second. In this model, we also take a very conservative view. It's fairly standard in North America, United States, to have a 3% year-on-year increase on electricity. That is not necessarily the case on a per utility basis, and most definitely on a per rate structure basis, which can be very specific in any given month. For this particular project, we were asked by the financiers to make sure that somehow, some way, this wasn't going to get upside down in terms of the finance structure. And so I went back in 10 years of this particular rate structure for SoCal Edison Omnibus 8 and looked at both the dollars per kWh that were being charged as well as the dollar per kWh or the demand charges. And what I found is that the energy was roughly 4% year-on-year, had an average increase. We modeled it at 3. And then the most interesting part was the demand charges had roughly a 19% year-on-year average over this period. And that's also interesting because it's the demand charges that are the most growing portion of a customer's electricity expense, and it's becoming more expensive more than the energy itself, and definitely more than what we modeled.
That's fascinating. That's fascinating, and that's a big chunk of the end customer's income, in addition to the wholesale opportunities that Ian described earlier. I just can't express to the audience enough how much expertise we have inside, not just in the utility bill analysis, which we're glad to help you with, but also with identifying in each utility territory where the opportunities are for wholesale services. Now, David, looking at a given deal, and we talked a lot about versatility earlier, but, you know, why does versatility matter?
Versatility matters because the longer duration, the longer lived assets, the more likely you are to experience different sorts of rate structures. You're going to experience different demand profiles over this period. And the utilities know this as well, and they're willing to incentivize different parts of your load so that you would use less electricity. They're willing to pay you. So this is what we affectionately call value stacking. Like, you could have energy shifting arbitrage, you could have demand charge reduction. In more and more of the utilities in the U.S., you'll see demand response. In this particular case, we were modeling critical peak pricing and capacity bidding programs. Now, when I go back to the financiers, one of the key questions that they'll ask is, how much of this contribution or intake is contracted revenue, which would be the energy shifting arbitrage and demand response, and how much of this is going to be market-based? And in doing it this way, especially with the support of Ian, we can very quickly break down the contributions of each one of these stacks or this pancake, if you will, in a stack of many.
That's fascinating. Okay. And so let me get this straight. Ian gives you the structure. You build the balance of system costs. We jointly put together the revenue streams. And so what comes out next?
Whatever is most meaningful for our customers and for our partners. If they're looking at a project payback that is break-even oriented, we can support that. If it's a leased or if it's a PPA-oriented structure, most of the time there's some sort of composite tax rate that can be afforded to them where they get some tax benefits, even if they can't absorb fully the ITC or any of the depreciation portion. So we can support composite after-tax flow, and of course, cumulative cash flow to make sure that whether it's under a lease or a PPA or it's cash or some other structure, that they know what their value is for that revenue-generating asset.
Excellent, excellent. And just to reiterate, all of these pro formas are all in one Excel sheet. We're happy to share it. And, you know, it's a situation where, you know, these pretty graphs, we've seen it now 100 times,
they pace themselves very well into a presentation to a decision maker and somebody who's holding the purse strings on a project. So all this is in there. It's pre-engineered. It's easy for you guys to roll out and start selling. So to wrap it up, everything we're doing at Vision is not just to build the world's greatest battery. We've invested in critical resources, and you've seen the tip of the iceberg today. We're here to help you scale your business. If you look at North American commercial industrial solar, there's about 150 companies out there who are deploying 85% of it. We're here to help you transition into large industrial solar and storage. We don't just do large industrial solar storage. This is one of our stories. We've got similar services to help you understand integrating large utility scale solar and storage, as well as wind, transmission and deferral economics for non-wires and substation expansion, diesel displacement for both mining and mineral and large agricultural applications in the developed and developing world, island and campus microgrids, made in America, so from a defense standpoint, forward and deployed and domestic military bases are real attractive for this technology as well. And just about anything that requires mission critical resiliency, we're here to help. So that really wraps up our presentation, and I want to open this up for Q&A. This question is, are you guys bankable? I'm going to hand that to David Mincer.
Oh, sure. Of course we are. It's a fundamental requirement to doing business in this space today in the modern era. Absolutely. We spent 6 months with Black & Veatch, who is a partner of ours, and they wallowed in 600 documents, visited two sites, ours here in the Design Center in Montana, as well as our contract manufacturer in St. Petersburg, Florida, that's Jabil. Jabil is the third largest contract manufacturer in the world, and we passed. I can't tell you if we were the first and only flow battery to have passed that bankability audit, but we're definitely in the top one or two. That's a great question.
The next question is in and around operations and maintenance, basically asking what the annual operation and maintenance is.
Yeah, great question. So for us, we have an annual service to come and revisit looking the balance of the electrolyte and a general QA/QC on the system. So once per year, we'll visit our systems. We also have 24/7 remote monitoring that will help us educate our service team and deal with any and all issues that may come up.
Excellent. The next question is one that we anticipated. It's basically, what is the all-in system cost, or what is the battery price? And it's a great question. It's really site-specific, but what most customers have told us is that when they start to look at our all-in system price, that we are very, very competitive within 5 to 10% on the first cost basis. And then when you start to look at the replacement cost over a 20-year period for lithium ion and our ability to generate incremental power and energy revenue services from the battery platform, that from an unlevered IRR perspective, it really hunts. Next question is, one other comment on all-in system cost is, we've seen dramatic improvements in the marketplace, and frankly, we're willing to quote projects out into 2017 and 2018, and we are keeping our head above water and competing out in those years. So don't be shy. Bring us your projects. We'll take a look. Next question is in and around the overall safety of the system. The person is asking about locating this next to a school. And so we are currently deploying significant projects around the world in areas that are both environmentally sensitive from a groundwater perspective and are very close to where people live and work and play. And if you take a look at potentially permitting and opportunity, and getting not just the permit, but the approval and insurance on, you know, whatever you might be close to, it begins to be quite a challenge in with some of the chemistries that are out there today. All right, there's a bunch of more redundant questions in here that I hope to address at a later date, but with that, I'm going to wrap up the webinar. I want to thank you all for coming, and we'll be publishing the content and a video within 24 hours. Have a great day.